You were involved in the attempted recovery of Don Jason, the longtime Clearwater manager who left the church properties in 1996. Isn't that right?
That's correct.
Well, tell us about that.
Okay, well, I was alerted to the fact that Don blew because Don was an important fish in terms of the Lisa McPherson case. And I had discussed this with Miscavige because he was very death. So when I got the word, you know, I was immediately in communication with security at Flag. I think I was even working, and I was back and forth between the international base and Flag a lot during that 96-97 period. And they did the whole blow drill, and they scoured Florida. They tracked them down to Georgia. Finally, got him to come back to Clearwater. He wouldn't come to the base itself. He wouldn't go into any church buildings, but he came at least back down to talk to somebody. I elected to go be the person to go talk to him. I thought I had the most influence with him, and I did. I spoke to him at a diner, and I got his cooperation to return, and he came back, and we did some sec checking, and began the process, and discussed it with Miscavige, and he said, I want the guy on the ship, because if you go to the ship, it's the most secure place in the world, because what happens if you go to the Freewinds in the Caribbean, you're out of the country, and the procedure there is, you turn your passport into the port captain, it's a post on the ship, he puts it in a safe, you don't have access to it. So even if you hop the ship in port, you can't get out of the country without a passport. So it was considered extremely secure. So we set up a little program, did it remotely, for Dawn to work on the decks, do physical work, study material, and get extensive, long-term confessional sec checks. So we get him in a position where his head was straight and he could be somewhat be trusted, and maybe we could slot him back into the organization somewhere down the road after he was reformed. Now, while he was there, he had written to me because he was getting real antsy about leaving because he didn't like the way he's being treated. He had told me that there was a reverse lock on his door in the cabin he was staying at on the Freewinds, so that when he went to bed at night, it locked from the outside. He couldn't get out. And I remember actually being surprised that they went to that length and got that corrected. He subsequently said he also had a camera in the room, which didn't go away. I don't recall what the situation was with that, but the point is, it was a little bit of a concern on people's mind because Don wasn't really happy with the program. And suddenly, one day, I'm down in Clearwater a few weeks or months into his stay on the ship, and I get this call. Don Jason is on a plane heading for Atlanta because he escaped the Freewinds, to which I was, you know, shocked, because how do you escape the Freewinds? You know, how do you get out of a Caribbean country without a passport? Well, ultimately, he can tell that story, but all I knew is he was on a plane, and Ludwig Alpers, who used to be a big gun in the Flag operation in the OSA office back, I guess, in the 80s, 90s, was now, at that time, the port captain of the ship. He had jumped on, gotten a seat on Jason's plane, and the report I got was Jason's on the plane, Alpers on the plane trying to get him back, and it's heading for Atlanta. So I believe it was in the morning time in Clearwater, I think Miscavige was sleeping. I told my wife, who was either my wife or somebody in the representative office, the RTC representative office, I'm getting on a plane to Atlanta to try to recover Don. Let COB know, Miscavige know when he gets up. And just hightailed to the Tampa airport, got on a plane, shot to Atlanta, got off the plane. I knew where Don was going. We knew what flight he was on. Ran to his bay where his plane was coming in, and got there just about the time his flight was unloading. He was getting off. Don was coming out of the down the airway, and I could see he was like kind of bothered because Ludwig was kind of pursuing him, and he didn't want to talk to him. And I don't even think he saw me. When he came off, I saw Ludwig. Ludwig saw me. I gave Ludwig a signal to take off because it was clear he wasn't having any impingement or influence on Don. And I followed Don. He went down to the smoking lounge, went in there, lit up a smoke. I walked in, and his jaw dropped because he didn't he just got away from Ludwig, and suddenly I was there. So anyway, Don and I spoke for the time period it took for the next flight, to get on the next flight. I don't remember how long it was, but for some time. And Don, you know, he always liked me and respected me, so it was, you know, he wasn't being antagonistic to me, but he just said, matter of fact, I'm not coming back. Forget about it. There's no future for me there. I don't want to play this game. You know, I feel like I'm being held on that ship. I'm going to be a prisoner. I'm not coming back. Well, I had gotten a ticket on the same plane already in anticipation of the fact that I might not be able to get him turned back from Atlanta. I had gotten a reservation on the same plane he was going from Atlanta to Milwaukee, where his mother lived. And so just about the time Don was getting ready to board the plane, just before that, I peeled off and called in. I was getting calls nonstop, and I called in. COB wants to talk to you, Miscavige. So I'm talking to him. I kind of debriefed on what happened with Don, and he just, you know, he ain't coming back. Well, put him on the phone. I want to talk to him. So Don's getting on the plane, and I come over, and I tell Don, Dave wants to talk to you. He says, well, I don't want to talk to him. Turns around, heads up the airway to the plane. And again, Don thinks this is the end of it, right? Well, 5 minutes later, I get on the plane, and Don's like three-quarters way back in the plane, and he's looking at some in-flight magazine. He puts his head up, and he sees me coming down the thing, and I get the second jaw dropped. You know, he's like, you know, it's like the Terminator. The guy just keeps coming, you know. And ultimately, it was funny because by the time we got to Milwaukee, because we didn't even talk on the plane, by the time we got to Milwaukee, I think it was a kind of a measure of resignation or respect or whatever, you know. And it was sort of like he was like, you know, you persisted this hard, I'll talk to you, you know. And we spoke and we talked about, you know, at least let's clean you up a little bit. You know, if you're not coming back, can we at least do some auditing, some sec checking, so you're going to feel better about yourself, feel better about the organization, whatever. Long and the short of it is I spent several days there. I went to his house. I met his mother, really nice lady. Developed some trust with her, you know, so she didn't feel bad about him coming to the hotel. And we did the sec checking and all that. And ultimately, Miscavige wanted him on camera with certain admissions so that he wouldn't be a threat in the future. So I had arranged through OSA to get some DSA, which is the local OSA guy, the Department of Special Director of Special Affairs, and I think the closest local church was Minneapolis St. Paul. And so some guy I had to work out the logistics for some guy to bring me a camcorder and with a tripod so I could do a whole and I had worked out all these confessions and waivers and agreements not to sue or disclose, you know, all these things for Don to sign, and did it on videotape to show it wasn't under duress and all that business. So I did that whole number with Don, and we actually at the end of it left relatively amicable. You know, from our perspective, you know, I felt he wasn't a threat. You know, in retrospect, from his perspective, the story's interesting and kind of funny in one respect, but it's sad in another because, you know, I look at his perspective from it. Here's a guy, you know, having to sign all these things, having to confess, knowing that literally it's being put in a file, you know, just in case his attitude doesn't remain the way we want it to remain, knowing that he's just giving me ammo to use against him, you know. And, you know, I never went through that process. When I blew, they never came after me. But I can only imagine sort of the feeling that would be to live under that